Well, I want to start by thanking Anthony for organizing this, and I think all of you know he does a fantastic job of not only organizing the programs, but for keeping us all apprised of when they're offered and reminders, because we all forget. So thank you. Thank you so much. Also, I must apologize. I am suffering from a cold, and so you'll forgive my sort of nasal and hoarse voice today. But I am delighted to be here because this is a topic that is very dear to me. I have been studying the topic of people returning to their home country for more than 20 years. And the project I'm going to discuss with you today, I've been working on for the past 6 years. So those of you who've been involved with long research projects, you know how that feels to finally get it finished and to have the opportunity to discuss it. So I just returned from 3 months in Asia, primarily in Hong Kong and Shanghai, where I had an opportunity to talk about this research project. And it's nice to be home and to be at a CUNY function to share these results. Let me just start off with a little story. There was an old farmer whose only horse ran away. Knowing that the horse was the mainstay of his livelihood, his neighbors came to commiserate with him. "Who knows what's bad or good?" said the old man, refusing their sympathy. Indeed, a few days later, his horse returned, bringing with it a wild horse. Now the old man's friends came to congratulate him. But he rejected their congratulations and said, "Who knows what's bad or good?" As it happened, a few days later, when the old man's son was attempting to ride the wild horse, he was thrown and broke his leg. Now the friends came to express their sadness about the son's misfortune. "Who knows what's good or bad?" said the old man. As it happened, the army came to the village to conscript all the able-bodied men to fight a war against a neighboring province. But the old man's son was not fit to ride and was spared. So, you know the next line. Life is full of changes, and it's never always clear what's good or what's bad. And I think that is the theme of the research and a lot of the experiences of the people that I interviewed returning back to their home country. So let's start off by just mentioning that humans have always been a very peripatetic species, right? Since the evolution of Homo sapiens, we have wandered the globe, and there's been a fair amount of examination of people's wanderings and their migration. What's a little more recent is to study what happens when they return to their home country. So let's start off by talking a bit about who returns home. And the United Nations estimates that there are about 100 million people who return home annually. It's a staggering figure. Now, who are they? Well, some of them are repatriated refugees who were forced out of their countries due to war, due to famines, and then ultimately return home. A large bulk of these people are what we call sojourners. These are people who are temporarily in another country. They could be students studying abroad, humanitarian workers, business employees, missionaries, diplomats, and a lot of seasonal workers, agricultural workers, and so forth. Most of the research I had done in the past focused on this particular group. Today I'm going to focus on a third group who are return migrants. And if we think about the 20th century as being one that's characterized by immigration, we can think of the 21st century as one being characterized by return migration, of people returning home. The problem of return migration, I'm a psychologist, as Anthony mentioned, and psychologists were very late getting into the examination and investigation of this area. In fact, some of the first to examine the role of immigration and return migration were artists. And I have a chapter in the book that looks at the art of a variety of Asian artists who incorporated this notion of multiple identities in their work. And I just draw your attention to the calligraphy that's in the corner of the book. Let me go backwards a minute. Right. What I find is that my friends who speak no Chinese will take a quick glance at this and say, oh, well, this is obviously something in Chinese, and don't take the time to look at it. My friends who speak and read Chinese look at it and say, this must be some ancient script because I can't understand it either. In fact, this is the work of the contemporary Chinese artist Xu Bing. And Xu Bing immigrated to the U.S. in the 1990s, and after a decade, wanted to incorporate his Chinese and American identity in some way in his research. And he created something called square word calligraphy. And what you're looking at is actually English letters. It's the title of the book. He was very gracious enough to put the book title into square word calligraphy. But it's English. It says R-E-T-U-R-N, and the second character actually spells out the word migration and identity. And so as a way to try and get people to think about East and West identity joined in terms of language. So artists have been looking at this issue for quite a while. Writers have also looked at this issue. I'm sure you're familiar with the work of Gish Jen, who is American-born but of parents from Shanghai, who has written about immigration, and Timothy Moe, who is Hong Kong-born but grew up in Britain. So there's a fair amount of writing about, you know, in novelistic form, about immigration, and just now some new novels about return migration. Historians have been looking at the issue of return migration also. I think for most people who grow up in the United States, we grow up with a myth that when immigrants came, the large immigration to the United States between 1880 and 1920, that people came to the U.S. and they loved it and they never went home. But in fact, historians and Mark Wyman in particular has discovered that 25% to 33% of all the European migrants who came returned to their home country. Now that's sort of a staggering number. It varied by ethnic group. So about 40% of Italian Americans returned home. So that was the largest group of returned migrants. Almost 0% of Jewish Russian immigrants returned home. So there's quite a range. But there have been some interesting articles and books about the history of return migration. Economists have also looked at the topic of return migration primarily from the vantage point of remittances, or more precisely, the lack of remittances once people return home, and the negative effect it has on people's home villages and their families and so forth when they are no longer in the U.S., for example, or Australia, Canada, and don't provide for the family the way they did. Sociologists and demographers have been studying the issue of return migration also from a societal point of view. But today I'm going to talk to you a little bit about what psychology can offer and what I'm finding in the research that I'm doing. Okay. For a number of years, I've been looking at a model of cultural transitions. And it looks at how people have tried to incorporate a new cultural identity into their home cultural identity. And there are four profiles which have emerged from my research. The first one is called affirmative. So those people who experience an affirmative identity after they have lived overseas find that their home identity has been strengthened as a consequence of being overseas. I once interviewed an American who was living in China, in Japan, and he said he never celebrated July 4th, Independence Day, when he lived in the States. But he gave the biggest July 4th parties since he had been living in Tokyo. And there's this sense of discovering or rediscovering your home culture. And for these people, they have an affirmative identity, a strengthening of their home culture. A second is subtractive identity. So people who experience a subtractive identity are ones who feel less a part of their home culture as a result of being overseas. So that when they go back home, they say, I don't fit in here anymore. I feel different than other people, of my compatriots. And they feel just less a part of their home country. The third profile is additive. And these are people who maintain their home culture values and identity and behaviors and way of thinking, but they add on to that the values and the behaviors of the place of immigration. So they have added on a second type of identity. We'll be talking about these three in more detail. The fourth and the one that I find less prevalent is a global identity. These tend to be people who have lived in multiple countries, and that after a while they don't feel particularly tied to any one country, but they in fact often use the terminology a world citizen. They feel that they are part of world culture, that they can easily fit in wherever they go. And in almost every country that I've studied returnees, there's a small percentage of people who fit this global identity. As I mentioned, most of the research I've done in the past has focused on sojourners, and in particular, sojourners who are returning to the West after an overseas experience. So let me just mention what I have found is a fairly uniform theme for those returning to the West. And as most of the subjects I've studied have come back to the US, to Europe, to Canada, to the UK, and that is a subtractive identity. These are people who feel less a part of their home culture. So for example, this was an American who was a Peace Corps volunteer, and he spent 2 years in Peru. And he was working with the indigenous people in Peru. And then he said, when I got back to my hometown in Ohio and went with my old buddies, I fell back into hanging out evenings in the neighborhood tavern. After about 2 weeks of that, I gave up the tavern. They didn't care about the problems of the Indians in Peru, and I didn't give a damn about what happened to the Indians in Cleveland. Of course, he meant the baseball team. But his sense was that he was no longer able to fit in with his compatriots, with his buddies. He didn't have the same interests. I interviewed a young woman who is Italian from Italy, and she had a 2-year sojourn in Sweden. And she similarly says, I've experienced the feeling of no longer fitting into my home country. And talking with other students, they had the same feeling. So this sense among Westerners that after an overseas sojourn, they just don't fit in any longer. They are different. They no longer feel apart. And I found a very interesting quote by the author Nathaniel Hawthorne. He wrote the book The Marble Faun in 1860, and it recounts a story about Americans who were living in Italy. So Hawthorne understood exactly this dilemma. He said, and now that life had so much human promise in it, they, meaning the Americans, resolved to go back to their own land. Because the years, after all, have a kind of emptiness when we spend too much of them on a foreign shore. We defer the reality of life in such cases until a future moment when we shall again breathe our native air. But by and by, there are no future moments. Or if we do return, we find that the native air has lost its invigorating quality, and that life has shifted its reality to the spot where we have deemed ourselves only temporary residents. Thus, between two countries, we have none at all, or only that little space in either in which we finally lay down our discontented bones. It is wise, therefore, to come back soon or never. So both novelists from the 19th century and contemporary returnees to the West feel this same subtractive identity. The other aspect of this is this sense of, in the West, you really can only have one identity. It's an either-or idea. That is, you can trace the roots of this either-or idea to ancient Greek philosophers whose ideas form the foundation of Western culture. And that is that you need to be consistent, that you can't have one way of behaving, one cultural way of behaving, and another cultural way of behaving, that you really need to have one way to behave. And I came across this really remarkable passage by Plato, right, 2,500 years ago, who said the best way of keeping consistent and keeping foreign elements out of our society was to minimize our contact with people who were different. And he said that the utopian state must be insulated from the outside world as much as possible. If there are foreign visitors, good care needs to be taken lest any of these is to be kept down to an avoidable minimum, and keep this category of visitor away because they may introduce a novel custom. Plato implores its citizens not to leave their homeland. No young person under 40 is even to be allowed to travel abroad under any circumstances, nor is anyone to be allowed to go for private reasons, but only on some public business, as a herald or an ambassador. If citizens do go abroad, they're obligated when they return to tell the younger generation that the social and political customs of the rest of the world don't measure up to their own. So we see the blueprint for this Western mentality and warning against the idea of having an additive identity, of having two different cultural identities. This is the blueprint for you have to be 100% American. And I think that Plato's ideas, you know, can be traced to the fact that Americans are still a country that doesn't venture far. Americans don't leave the U.S. very much. I'm sure you all know only about 20% of Americans have passports, right? When you think about what that means and how little interaction, and in fact, until recently, it was about 10% of the population. But when, after 9/11, and you needed a passport to get to the Caribbean to go on a cruise, another 10% got passports. So I think the this idea of interacting with people who are different and going abroad and so forth, those of us who are involved in study abroad find it still a challenge to convince students that it's worth their while to spend a semester in another country. You know, I often hear them say, you know, well, I can take those courses here. I say, but it's not the same to study, you know, Italian film here or in Italy, or Chinese history here or in our CUNY program in Shanghai. So it's still hard to convince them to go. The third aspect of coming back home for Westerners is psychological distress. Almost all of their returning home is characterized by this sense of distress, of discomfort and unhappiness at being back home. There was a woman who returned to Finland, and she said, coming back home was more difficult than going abroad because I expected changes when going overseas. During repatriation, it was a real shock. I felt like an alien in my own country. Surprisingly, I was totally unprepared for the long, harsh, cold, dark Arctic winter. And that emotional distress is found over and over again. So, and if you went overseas with a family, they also experienced distress. So my research question really was, is this a universal response to going overseas? That is, are cultural transitions and coming back home always characterized by a subjective identity, where there's this sense of that you can't have two different cultural identities, and psychological distress? At the time, I was doing a lot of reading about Hong Kong. And I'm sure all of you know that the 99-year lease on Kowloon was up in 1997. And in 1984, the Chinese and British governments concluded the Sino-Chinese agreement, handing back Hong Kong in 1997. This sent Hong Kongers into a panic at the thought of living under Chinese sovereignty. And between 1994 and 1997, 800,000 people immigrated from Hong Kong. This was 1/6 of the Hong Kong population, a really remarkable number of people leaving one particular country. And not only that, they were among the most educated of the population. They were among the most professional. They were managers, and they were senior administrators, both in the Hong Kong government and in private industry. They scattered to many different countries, but the two most popular destinations were Australia and Canada. A smaller number went to the U.S., to the U.K., to New Zealand, and to 40 other countries as well. So looking for a homogeneous group to study, this seemed like the perfect one, because starting in 1997 after the handover, and people sort of held their breath to see what would happen, and the sky didn't fall in Hong Kong. Slowly, Hong Kongers returned home. And the estimates are that about 500,000 have returned home since 1997. So who are they, and why did they return? And more pointedly, what was their psychological profile? Did they have that subtractive idea that many others have had, or was there something unique about them? So I was funded on a Fulbright grant and spent 6 months interviewing returnees using both sort of far-ranging interviews and also psychological scales. And I'm going to jump right to the summary of results. And you're going to see a theme emerge very quickly. Cultural identity flexibility, linguistic flexibility, psychological flexibility. You see the theme comes out very quickly. Cognitive, behavioral, attitudinal, and work ethic flexibility. There was a remarkable amount of both pragmatism on the part of the Hong Kong returnees and flexibility in moving back and forth between cultures. So let me go through these quickly. Cultural identity flexibility. Let me just focus on here. The vast majority of my interviewees exhibited additive profiles. And in fact, 31 out of the 50, but also 5 had a combination of additive and affirmative, and 2 more had additive and subtractive combined. So it was very clear that people did not feel less Hong Konger. They didn't feel less Chinese. They didn't feel less a part of Hong Kong. They just had added on their Australian or their Canadian identity. And we talked about how they did that and the specific behavioral ways they did that, and we'll talk about those in a minute. So what was very interesting was, rather than the Western idea of either or, that you had to be American or you had to be French or American or Chinese, it was this idea is that you could have multiple identities. Linguistics. Very interesting. I have a colleague at Hong Kong University, and she's been looking at Cantonese English code switching and what among returnees. So these are returnee college students. And what she found is that it's not that they use Chinglish, this combination of Chinese and English, but rather that they maintain their Cantonese and their English, and that sometimes in utterances of 400 words, kids would switch back and forth between Cantonese and English 26 times. So there was this sense that they felt equally comfortable and were able to express their ideas in two languages almost simultaneously. I'm going to skip some of these just so we can to move through. This was the other finding that to me was the most remarkable, because in the 15 years I had done research with Westerners coming home, in addition to the subtractive identity, the finding that was most consistent was how much distress people had coming back. And with the Hong Kongers, there was practically no psychological distress. On scales of satisfaction with life, the Hong Konger returnees scored very high. On a scale of repatriation distress, they scored very low. And in my interviews, I kept probing because it was such an unusual finding. I kept saying, you know, could you give me some example of when you had some kind of problem, upset? And the subjects kept saying, I didn't have any problems. You know, in fact, one finally said to me, why do you keep asking that question? It really was fine. I felt very comfortable coming back home. There was what some newspaper pundits called the astronaut phase, which was mostly the husbands would come back to Hong Kong initially, flying back and forth between Hong Kong and Vancouver or Hong Kong and Sydney. Following that phase, when the family was reunited in Hong Kong, it was a very stable time. Also, there was a lot of interpersonal flexibility. So recall that additive doesn't mean that you have eliminated your home culture way of behaving, but you have added on some. So a lot of people talked about the fact that they were more independent in their thinking, that they were willing in the workplace to express their individual opinions, which before they went overseas, they might have been reluctant to do that. Another which was very interesting was this higher need for privacy after living in Australia or Canada. So one of my interviewees recounted the story how in her workplace, every day, everyone in her work section would have lunch together. And she said, you know, before I moved to Canada, it never occurred to me not to have lunch with my work group. But she went off for 4 years to Vancouver, then she returned to her same workplace, and she said she just didn't want to do it 5 days a week. So 3 days a week she would have lunch with her work group, and 2 days a week she'd go off on her own. That she found this sense of individual time and the need for privacy was something that was fostered when she was in Canada and felt that she could sort of use both types of behaviors, if you will. Cognitive flexibility. I found that situational or contextual thinking was very clear in almost all of the interviewees. They were willing to change how they thought and how they behaved depending on whether they were with their families who never left Hong Kong or whether they were with an international workplace. So some of them would talk about how you know, when I'm in the workplace, I work in an international company in Hong Kong. I'm very expressive of my opinion, but when I'm with my extended family at home, it's something that I know is not appreciated as much, and I'll refrain from that. They also were involved in very detailed planning in terms of the future. Many of them returned to Hong Kong not only because of good jobs, but because they wanted their children to be multilingual. And so while they spoke Cantonese at home and the children were learning English in the schools, they now in the schools in Hong Kong, Mandarin was being taught. And they felt that a good reason to return to Hong Kong was so that their children could be trilingual and not just bilingual. They talked about their behavioral preferences in terms of food. Those who had spent time in Australia talked a lot about how much they love barbecue and how they try to maintain that. Schooling preferences, many of them sent their children to the Canadian school or the Australian school in Hong Kong, also the English Schools Foundation, so that their children could have both a Western way of learning, but within the Hong Kong context. Nonverbal behaviors, this was an interesting one, because there were changes in people's rate of gesturing, facial expression, and even pace of life. So one woman told me, I mean, those of you who've been to Hong Kong, you know how quickly people walk in Hong Kong. And a woman said that she had been in Sydney about 1 week. She was walking through a park, and a woman was sitting on a park bench and said, "Did you just arrive from Hong Kong?" And the woman said, "Yes." "How did you know?" She said, "Nobody in Sydney walks that fast." And she said that, in fact, over the couple of years that she was there, not only did the pace of life slow down, but her pace of walking slowed down dramatically. And when she returned to Hong Kong, she said she was there for a week, and she went down to Causeway Bay on a Saturday, and she was nearly trampled because, you know, the kind of leisurely pace. So she said, it made it very clear to me that I had to pick up my pace in order to feel comfortable there as well. Let's see. I want to mention one other behavioral aspect of being flexible, and that's housing preferences. Many of the interviewees said that the one thing they really missed about Canada and Australia in particular was having outside space, a lawn, a backyard, a garden of some kind. So some of the returnees, if they were able, moved to the new territories so that they could have some of that sort of Canadian or Australian type of experience when they went back home. Attitudinal flexibility. Most of the returnees talked about being more environmentally conscious after living in Australia and New Zealand. In particular, and Canada to a lesser extent. One woman said that she brought back to Hong Kong her refrigerator. And her friends were teasing her, saying, "Why would you bring a refrigerator back to Hong Kong, you know, from Australia?" And she said, "Well, why not? It was just a year old." And sort of environmental awareness and issues of sustainability are not probably as high or prevalent in Hong Kong. But many of the people who've returned are now finding that they are getting involved with environmental action groups. Also, people coming back are more involved with political life. So July 1st was the day that the handover took place, and there have been demonstrations now for 10 years on July 1st with Hongkongers who are demonstrating for more political autonomy, for elections sooner, and so forth. And so there are lots of people who find that once they come back, they bring these ideas of participation in political life. Albert Cheng, who was a pro-democracy radio personality, had declared his candidacy for Hong Kong legislature. And he was very critical of the Hong Kong government, and he felt that Beijing was meddling in Hong Kong affairs. And he said that he was fighting for the liberal values he had learned in Canada. "I have to stand up against violence and against any evil force that wants to shut me up. This is a Canadian value. It's something I learned in Canada." What was also interesting is this notion that individuals can affect political outcomes, the idea of political efficacy. And I heard this spoken by many of my returnees. Work ethic. This was a particularly interesting result in that almost every Hong Konger remarked about how the pace of work was so much more relaxed in Canada and Australia. But in fact, it made them feel uncomfortable. They all said that they never felt like they did a good day's work because going home at 5 o'clock was like going home in the middle of the day. And many of the migrants said that they would work later because they just felt that it was not a good day's work to leave at 5. And pretty soon their co-workers were getting perturbed because the Hong Kongers were in the office till 9, 10 o'clock at night. Ultimately, the bosses often said, go home. You know, I go home at 5 o'clock. You should go home at 5 o'clock. And one of my interviewees said, what do you do when you go home at 5 o'clock? He wasn't even sure. So his friend said, well, you can go out with your kids and you can go to a movie with your wife. And so they all said that they enjoyed being able to spend more time with their family. But there was always this unease that they were not being a good worker. So in this case, everyone readjusted to the Hong Kong work schedule. And I said to all of them, how did that feel to go back to working, you know, 6 days a week? And they all said, great. It felt great because now I knew I was really putting in the work that I should. And I got a sense of this when I first got there. It was my plan that I would interview people during lunch, during their lunch hour. So I started to call potential interviewees and I would say, you know, can we meet for lunch to discuss your coming home? And they say, oh, I don't take lunch. And I said, okay, well, how about if we meet after work? And there was this pause on the line and the man said, you want to interview me at 10 o'clock at night? And I said, aha, okay, how about Saturday? And he said, oh, I work on Saturday. So I said, how about Sunday? Oh, no, that's family day. So I thought, oh, my God, I just got a Fulbright grant to do research, and I can't find any subject who has the time to spend 2 hours with me to talk about their reentry. It was, had a moment of panic there with the data collection. But fortunately, people were willing to make some adjustments in their schedules. Okay, so why the additive? Why did that come through so clearly with the Hong Kong returnees? Well, as I mentioned with the Westerners who have a 2,500-year blueprint for how to think internationally, so do Hong Kongers. And if you look at Confucian teachings of about harmony and Taoist teachings in particular about this notion of both and, that you can have two things, that you can have contradictions and work through them through compromise, you begin to see that there's a very long tradition of being able to have two cultural identities. Also, there's the peculiar nature of Hong Kong society, which has been so international for more than 200 years. So you have many of the people I interviewed talked about having a core of Chinese values, and then the overlay of 150 years of British culture and values and education, English language, and then the emergence of a Hong Kong identity, which people see as quite separate from a Chinese identity. Then added to this is the immigrant identity of either Canadian or Australian, and now another layer of cultural identity of return migrant. So you have people who have both a history of the society of international, and then within each individual, a sense of multiple identities already. You know, when Deng Xiaoping said that there would be one country and two systems. A lot of people in the West found that that was sort of inconceivable. Again, because how can you have both? How can you have two systems in one country? But I think that that also underscores the sense of having, living within some contradictions. Oh, I found this quote, Ruxiang Sui Su, when visiting a new town, follow their customs. So there was an adage from the far past about the importance of adjusting and adaptation. What about the future for Hongkongers? More cultural transitions. There are now thousands of Hongkongers who are working in the mainland, primarily in the Pearl River Delta, and the Hongkongers continue to be flexible. A colleague of mine at the Hong Kong University of Science and Technology did a study in 2008 and found that among Hongkongers who are now living in China, they are more likely to identify as Chinese rather than as Hongkongers. So there are additional changes going on in terms of flexibility. One question that remains to be explored, and I guess I would leave this to my sociology colleagues, which is, what is the long-term effect of having 500,000 returnees on Hong Kong society? And I just mentioned briefly sort of politics and environmental awareness, but there may be other aspects of Hong Kong culture which will be influenced and perhaps shaped by the returnees. Also, what is the effect of mainland migration to Hong Kong? And that is a growing influence as well, as mainlanders are coming to Hong Kong not only as tourists, but to work in Hong Kong. So I think that we will continue to see changes in terms of cultural identity, flexibility, and influences on identity. Let me just briefly mention a few words about mainlanders going home. There is a much less research that's been done on this topic, and actually I just found out yesterday, those of you who applied for a PSC CUNY grant, I just got a PSC CUNY grant to do some research looking at Shanghainese coming home, and I'm going to be doing that with a colleague at Shanghai University. There are fewer return migrants coming back to the mainland. The largest numbers who are returning are those who went as students, so the sojourner category. And the estimates are about 400,000 students who then turn professional while they were overseas are returning home. Another group which is returning to the mainland are the BTCs. So it's the ABCs and the CBCs are adopting the philosophy of back to China. So these are second and third generation Chinese, and that would also be, I think, an interesting group to examine. I'm most interested in this group, and this is the group that I'm going to be examining when I start this project. But I've done some pilot work on it, and I'm sure that many of you have seen the description of these returnees as Hai Gui, sea turtles, referring to those who lived overseas and have returned home. My preliminary data has shown that there is some evidence of additive profiles among the mainlander returnees, But what is more common is an affirmative identity. That is, the time spent overseas has reinforced Chinese identity. These young professionals going home seem very happy to go back and very proud of the accomplishments of China, and are, in fact, in a recent study, are as nationalistic as those who never left. So, for instance, in a statement in a survey, you know, how many of you agree with the statement, my country, right or wrong, mainlanders who studied abroad are as often agree with that statement as those who never left China. And the statement, using force to promote China's national interest is acceptable, again, you found that returnees agreed with that statement as much as those who never went overseas. And the self-perception seems to be that they consider themselves modern Chinese and not Westerners. Some of these returnees, I've asked, you know, why is it that you are feeling so proud to return home, why your identity has been strengthened? And many of them commented that while living in the West, they were appalled at the ignorance and the bias in the West about China, the lack of knowledge about modern China. Second, that a lot of them just felt the pull of coming back and helping the country develop. Also, a lot of Chinese students who then, you know, become young professionals found that the internet allowed them to immerse themselves in Chinese culture while they were overseas, and that they didn't have as much of a separation from China as past study abroad students might have had, so that they could, you know, keep in touch with their friends through social networking, see the news, watch Chinese films, and so forth. And also that some have said, I didn't particularly find this in my research, but some of my colleagues have found that that a lot of these young people coming back are very assertive, and they attribute that to be a consequence of the one-child policy. Okay. I did find, again, in this pilot study, some people did exhibit additive bicultural identities. And there have been some interesting psychological studies looking at some behavioral differences, whether somebody was working at a local company or an international company. So in this case, the setting would make a difference into how they thought of themselves. If in an experimental situation they were speaking Mandarin or English, they would have different ways of thinking. And also in these studies, if they were primed with either Chinese or Western symbols, or asked to focus on the word I versus the word we, that there would be a switch between thinking of American individualistic thinking versus more group-oriented thinking. Okay, so finally, again, in this pilot study, what I started to find is that the psychological consequences of coming back home and adjustment depended in great part on the job that the returnees had. So those who returned home and went to state-owned companies, about 50% of them quit after a short period of time. They felt that the restrictions were such that they just felt too uncomfortable. On the other hand, of those who returned to university jobs, they seemed to be extremely successful. Just to give you an idea, 75% of the faculty at Beida are returnees. So that in a lot of universities and schools within universities, there's a very high percentage of returnees. So, of course, new returnees feel fairly comfortable. Of those who are returning as entrepreneurs, they are the most successful. When I was in Shanghai, I read a remarkable statistic that there's nearly 6,000 startups in the past couple of years, all created by returnees. So they are the ones who have the least difficulties because they have no institutional problems to deal with, no sort of entrenched kind of thinking. What will happen in the future in other workplaces, municipalities are beginning to recruit returnees and are setting up high-tech zones. So there's a draw throughout the country to individual cities. And of course, international companies are recruiting the returnees. But realize that many of the returnees have been in the U.S. or in Canada for 8 to 15 years. So their networks are kind of stale, and they need some time to readjust themselves and to reestablish their networks. So let me just end by saying that it's important for us to think about these issues of going back home for practical reasons. Not just to help companies and so forth, but to help individuals and individual families. And of course, you all know this famous quote by Confucius, isn't it a pleasure to make practical use of something you studied? So I'm hoping that people who work with returnees will be able to make practical use of some of this data. So let me take questions now. Yes.
I have a question is, did you ever ask the question of them, why did they return home? Mm. And was it, were most of your interviewees from Hong Kong and not so much from the mainland?
Right.
Because then you just dealt with those who could speak good English and not with those that had poor English.
Okay. Yes, well, I asked them all why they came back. And the number one reason by far was economic. The economy in Hong Kong was strong, and the economies in Canada and Australia at the time were weak. And not only that, because so many people had left Hong Kong, businesses and even the public sector were offering very high salaries if people would come back. So they were drawn primarily for economic reason, but as I mentioned, secondarily for family reasons, that they wanted to ensure that their children would be trilingual. The second point was, well, with this particular study, yes, they were all Hong Kongers coming back, but they had all lived between 2 and 6 years in Australia or Canada. So their English, they were all fluent in English, but I had a bilingual research assistant who went with me for all the interviews, and all of the psychological scales I had translated into traditional characters so they could fill out the psychological scales either in English or in Chinese. Yes?
Do you think, in a sense, this case of Hong Kong is unique? Of course, all cases are unique, but the almost unique circumstance of reverting to China in 1997, and a lot of the people, therefore, who went abroad or became citizens of Canada or Australia and so on were, in fact, you could say hedging or taking out insurance. Mm. And they may have intended from the beginning that if everything works out okay in Hong Kong, they will come back. And so there, in that sense, they were different from a lot of international immigrants.
Right, right. Yes. There were a lot of people who thought, I'm going to go and get a Canadian citizenship and then go back. But there's a sociologist at Hong Kong U, Wong Siu Lun, who did a study of intentions to immigrate and intentions to come home. And he found that there's very little correlation between people's intentions and what they in fact did. And so... And I think that just speaks to the fact that you have a lot of fluidity. You have students who think they're going to get their degree and come back and who stay longer. Or you have people who think they're going to immigrate and stay forever who come back. And it's somewhat artificial, I think, for the convenience of researchers to talk about these different kinds of returnees. But in fact, people's ideas about what they're going to do and so forth, I think changes a lot. I think we need to be aware of that. I mean, the reason I began looking at return migrants as opposed to return sojourners is because I thought, well, if you thought you were going to be living for the rest of your life in another country, you would have a different motivation to adjust than if you thought, oh, I'm just going to be here for 2 years and so forth.